Halo, selamat sore teman-teman. Selamat datang ke IPA. Sore ini kita sudah kedatangan teman-teman yang akan presentasi. Yang akan presentasi di sini diawali dengan nanti ada sedikit pembukaan dari Stefani di sini, karena baru-baru ini juga dia mengadakan diskusi tentang Nenek Project ini. Kemudian ada juga project-project lain yang masih beririsan dengan Nenek Project ini. Nanti akan diperkenalkan satu persatu. Akan diperkenalkan satu persatu oleh Stefani. Dan tadi kami sempat memikirkan gimana ya mungkin format yang paling menarik supaya teman-teman nggak terlalu lama menahan pertanyaan. Juga akan ada sesi tanya jawab di setiap akhir presentasi. Nanti kira-kira akan ada 4 orang yang presentasi dan di sela-selanya selalu akan ada tanya jawab gitu aja. Kalau mengenai IPA sendiri, kami di sini adalah lembaga arsip seni rupa untuk ini aja ya.
Yang gak tahu.
Yang belum pernah datang ke sini, ini perpustakaan dan area publik ini silakan dimanfaatkan. Silakan menghubungi nanti kalau di IPA itu ketemunya sama Melisa. Kalau mau bikin acara, kalau untuk perpustakaannya sendiri bukanya hari Senin sampai Jumat jam 9 sampai jam 5.
In English, please.
Half of them don't speak English.
They already know. I gave them a short book. You're okay, right? Ya, akan dilanjutkan langsung ke Mbak Stefani. Saya juga mau undur diri sini sambil ngomong akan ada di sekitar sini. Oke? Okay?
Sambil ngomong.
Terima kasih, Rita. Yeah, I'm very happy that so many people came. Thank you. I'm Stefani. Thank you so much, Eva, Peter from Eva, for hosting this event. And thank you so much, LifeBridge and Uchuk from LifeBridge for organizing this. We today have an event in the framework of a larger project that's going on since 4 months. It's called the Nene Project. It's about grandmothers and mothers and all the ladies in Yogyakarta. We do a lot of interviews with different women who are themselves are makers or hackers in a sense. And today we will have speakers who talk about Nene in international context, not only the Nene here. We already had one event at Kunchi Culture Center where we also had a discussion about the project. And in March 10th, we will have an exhibition opening at the Yogyakarta Contemporary, and I hope that you can come and see the results of the whole project. So today, I want to welcome our keynote speaker, Raoul Schmidt. He is an artist, and he is also an archivist of film, in the Vienna Film. Yeah. And he is also staff member at the very legendary Ludwig Boltzmann Institute of History and Society, and he graduated in photography at the University of Fine Arts in Vienna, and he is now a doctorate student, PhD candidate at the University of Art in Linz in Austria. And I hope that after each lecture we can have maybe a small debate or discussion so you can say what you think. Just a few slides about the Nene Project. Oops. So it's a collaboration between LifeBridge, the Citizen Lab for Art, Science and Technology, and me, I'm an artist from Austria, and Cindy Lin, who is an anthropologist from Singapore. And if you have any grandmothers and mothers who are hackers, please let us know, and we come to your house. So, we are very interested in hacking as a practice, but not only as a practice of hacking technology, but also as a practice of hacking culture, hacking processes, hacking communities, hacking patterns and norms. And in that sense, I will give over to you and your agent of change.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm very pleased to be here. Now I have just to check out the computer and find the presentation. Only 4 years after it was founded, it incorporated small gauge films in the collection. The admission and the preservation of small gauge films has pursued it by the Film Museum. since its beginning and was carried out through the 1970s and 80s, slowly but continually, with different genres like amateur films and, of course, home movies, but also accompanying the avant-garde film. We can do some example later on. Which brings me to the point of the collection Politics. The Austrian Film Museum and my colleague who co-authored this lecture is at the Austrian Film Archive. They collect small gauge films, perceived both as a form of artistic expression on its own and a source of historiography. A self-representation and outward ethnography, they provide information of the cultural framework conditions in which an amateur filmer perceives and positions himself or herself. Therefore, it's redundant to speculate if the films are primary, a parallel, or a complementary resource of history. In that sense, the Austrian Film Museum adheres to different acquisition policies than other archives in the German-speaking country, as there would be a well-known Bundesfilmarchive, a state archive of the of Germany, describing the acquisition as follows. A profound assessment decision is based both on comprehensive knowledge and contemporary history, but also on film technological knowledge. This notion disregards the value of everyday life. Referring to the significance of amateur films and home movies as records and documents of everyday life. As the historians have remarked at length, in the folds of their everyday life, the forces of society lay in wait. The exclusive estimation of amateur films and home movies on the basis of technological knowledge and knowledge of contemporary history only proves to a misleading. This is shown in the following from the Bundesarchive. Inherently, the Bundesarchive does not collect amateur films for their own sake, but as conscious supplement to the professional film production. This view fails to recognize the deeper meaning of amateurism. The later filmmakers, amateur filmmakers, independent film authors, and film artists have seen their works rarely as a supplement to the industrial production. The reduction of home movies to the opposite pole or supplement to the film industry leads to this misjudgment of the phenomenon home movies. Oh, that's institutions which are open to the historiography of films have cast off this approach by now. Home movies have meanwhile become recognized as non-industrial film. But how did that come? And we come to the head of all archives in the cooperation where they work together, the Federation International des Archives du Film. And they started back then in 1997 during the 53rd FIAF conversion, and the symposium Out of the Attic, Archiving Amateur Film was held. And that's what they said. We, the FIAF, we are aware of the fact that amateur productions has not received the attention that it deserves. Among the other reasons, because of the difficulties to define all the concepts involved in the term amateur. Besides those related with finding, classifying, preserving, and reusing the material. These issues will be the studies in our journey. However, the symposium that was held in the 40th FIAF Congress in Vienna 1984 seems to have been more for the reassessment of amateur films, given its earlier date and the detailed theoretical discourse on the subject, as well as the first attempt to establish a taxonomy of private and non-industrial film. The symposium titled "The Importance of Non-Industrial Cinema Within Our Cultural Heritage" was arranged and presented by the Austrian Film Museum. And it took place in April 1984. Very little had been discussed until the 80s and critically reflected in literature until the director of the Film Museum first presented the upcoming symposium at the FIAB meeting in 1983. This perspective relates to the topic that non-industrial film explicitly to the preservation of our cultural heritage. The symposium of Sofia intends to create interest in the preservation of film formats that have to date been neglected, so in the 1980s. From a contemporary perspective, the contribution to the symposium in 1984 by Jonas Mekas is one of particular relevance in deepening the discourse of amateur film. Mekas describes a personal attempt at indexing such materials and also a newer evaluation of such private documents. That is autobiographical diaristic experience. Into one or other kind of form, that is biography, autobiography, memoirs, confessions, reflections, testament, diary, log, sketch, book, notebook, travelog, notebook, there are nature of place or self, or autoportrait, portrait, postcard, letter, reminiscence, acquisition of home or visiting places, visiting people, self-analysis, self-confessions, and so on. Which leads us to another topic that we have to have another look on this amateur films. And in 1971, Stan Brackett suggested the term filmic memory. In 1978, John Stuart Katz does research on the autobiographical film. And as mentioned, Jonas Mekas lectures about the autobiography diaristic experience at Sphere Conference. In 1999, the French theorist Laurence Allard suggests to summarize significant parts of experimental cinema and home movies as cinema privé and cinema personnel. Roger Audin, one of the first series of amateur film, used the term ego productions, whereas the American film historian David James researches the differences between film diary and diary film. All of this proposed concept serve to label the very same, the autobiographical film. Instead of adding yet another term to this list of concepts, we archivists from the Film Museum or so on suggest to refer to the term ego document. And this has been in use with historians as analyses and exploration of written documents since the 60s. The term ego document was coined by Dutch historian Jacques Dresser and refers to the historical source with a strong personal characteristics. In this source, the first person narrator has put his experience with the surrounding world down in writing. But in Germany, Wilfried Schulze takes up the term and attains its meaning to include documents that were prepared and collected by official authorities. In addition to the voluntary introspections Brezza had in mind, Schulze incorporated police files, legal documents, testaments, and publica labite, and so on. Following Schulze, ego documents are documents which provide information on a person in his family, municipality, country, or his social class through voluntary or forced self-perception. In terms of the amateur film, the umbrella term ego document is not connected to certain aesthetic categories. It seems very neutral and very productive as it integrates existing definitions from literary artistic traditions like biography and autobiography. We suggest to use this term ego document linked to its own theoretical discourse in history and literary studies, and make it fruitful for film studies as term to analyze specifications of autobiographical film. These deliberations are accompanied by certain endangerments. Maybe the heritage could be anonymous. But th- just as a little introduction to that what I'm talking about, but let's go to Austria, where it's now very valuable to collect amateur films. During the last years, Austrian audiovisual archives increased the exposition of amateur films and home movies through regional summons in different federal states of Austria. Example from Tirolia, where they had a project in 2011, and they collected films in southern Tirolia, and Tirolia digitized them and gave them back to the owners. So we consider these films as lost because they never found the way in the archive. And there's another one run by the Film Museum now. It's all in German, it's a website, because it's local, and we try to collect amateur films in Vienna. And we have different thoughts about that. And that's Lower Austria, also from another archive, and they collected 70,000 films. Yeah, and they promised to digitize. They promised to digitize them and give back the digitized versions to the people, but it's such a huge amount that they lack their, they shift the end of the project to next year, to next year, to next year. This would be a critical analysis in my thesis I'm working on, but here it's meant to say that the difference in the processing depth and the single donations in different audiovisual archives is ranging from a sheer quantitative collection, like getting all 70,000 films across the whole country in the collections, and to a more in-depth quality work combined with oral history interviews the Austrian Film Museum likes to do. And the Film Museum collects avant-garde film works of female key figures like Maya Deren, Lisa Ponga, Bunny Export, Eve Heller, and Linda Christenell. Ah, okay, I have to speak up. So, okay, but the best part is just coming. But numbers of gender distribution, let's go to the next slide. And we have the 70,000 films that they collected. We did an evaluation, and you see male film amateurs, female amateurs, collective, whereas not true what both films. Cine clubs is very low because they don't pass the films. And then we have like 5% of orphan films. So female amateurism in Austria is very underrepresented. The film archive holds 2,735 small world films and a total of 70,000 films. This is the percentage. I will cut that and give you that 4,900 films are from female authors. The statistics show us that female amateur filming is to be considered as a great exception. The mediatization of the private base is in the hands of the male head of the household. Amateur filmmaking is overall a male practice. The amateur film industry established and confirms, produces and reproduces male-driven practice on amateur filmmaking. Women in post-war society are reduced to advertising only, and I have some examples from VDTA movie camera contest, where you had to guess measurements of the woman to win a prize to do your film with a Hollywood director. And this is another example of that. It's very slow here, but you can, the bikini pants are removable, you can tickle on the chest, and it's like that. But the next home is, of course, the simplicity of using a camera, and even, which is also written there, it's very easy to do a film thing. You don't even have to know about the whole camera. So I have to switch that because I want to bring in that what it's about. It's about the grandmothers, and it was a bit like Doña, that's his family, as female portraits the family, and we come to a state of Margaret Veit, and that's where it gets interesting, because now She is one of, she's the first female film amateur whose estate went into an archive and was possessed. And I get back to my papers. She is 79 years old today, and she is filming since 1955, and is still doing so until the present day. She is a so-called lone worker, not organized in a cinema club or amateur film cinema club. She started with photography, and this is a starting point of Margaret Feil's strategy of memory. The diligent framing shots, single shots rather than sequence shots, and rare pans reach back to her exercises in photography. And as mother of four children, she developed a very kind to cut her films in the camera, because she said to me, oh, you know, for killer children, the shot has to be perfect, and I have to have only a single shot, and then I have to look to the kids. Everyday life is shaping her filmic term. The mother of four is capturing the process of her children growing up later on, traveling in the main subject of her films. In her first years as film amateur, she develops manuals, scripts, storyboards, and she finds less and less time to edit her films. As we see here, it's very things she notes down. She makes some framings. She makes like a script what she's gonna film, and we find this in her storyboard, which also were collected in the thing, which is unique for an amateur filmmaker to have storyboards like that, and we find that in her movies. A classical movement, or only two pictures, I will make it. Okay. A classical movement is of a mother is presenting the newborn to the movie camera, operated by the father, of course. That's like, you know. And Patricia Zimmerman argues that filming the newborn is a spectacle of paternity, of patriarchy, of the fallos, of the beginning of family. Margaret Feil changes her role as a passive protectionist to the active filmmaker. She's the one operating the camera, however, she doesn't exploit filming to the regulated family life. Rather, she uses the medium to visualize her wishes. The following film, and I at least want to show one film example. The following film is showing that. Now I have to make this a bit smaller. And go back to my stick. Don't you see it? And we see a film. She directed with her. And it's silent, and it says Eastern 1956 with our 5 months old son Walter, and I will translate. Can I get rid of this? And on this note, there's written, please feed the baby with a bottle. I give you a kiss, a kettle. And now the father is performing. That's her. Today is in the 50s, and of course everything is staged. She told me yes, I had this wish that he would help me with the children, and so I had to stage everything and then place a camera and go back. This was actually a kind of wish. They are divorced now, she has a father for children, she's the one fulfilling everything, and the grandchildren say, oh, what's this kid?
Double click.
Oh no. Escape on first, maybe there's another shortcut, and not. So we see again her film practice, like with her assistant, and what she keeps tracks of all her movies since the 50s, and she is combining life and her film practice in this life. But it's hard to recognize at point 26. She knows that she is in the first months of her pregnancy, and this is inside her film. Inside her film list. But Margaret also keeps tracks of suitcases, and she writes down where she bought the suitcase. She bought the suitcase for 178 German marks, which were 2,250 shillings, and she bought it in Munich, and it lasts from 83 to 89, I guess, and then she wrote down everything for her journeys inside, and of course she's filming, but she keeps a list where the suitcase was, and it's like a list of imaginary films she is doing, and she's loading this everything down, and that's the next big suitcase. It's from 82 to 1991, and she gave her, there's written, she gave her all the suitcase away, so her structure is like on film, on archive, and she has everything stored at home, and now we brought this to the archive. But most Austrian audiovisual archives, they don't collect like this everyday life. They are not interested so much in amateur filmmaking, even more for female. She's the only female which is in archive now. The rest is like digging, and there are so many diploma projects in this for deal with that. And if you imagine you have 70,000 films, how to process this in the depth we did with Market Fight. We did a lot of oral history interviews. We know about her life, her divorce, her children, how it is filming. She scripted a video, and now I have to come. Oh, 3 minutes, so I was rushing a bit. The Margaret Fein is one of the first collection of living female amateurs, besides as tales of female film avant-garde in Austria, and gives the insight in her biography in everyday life of a woman in the Austria from the 50s, because she started from the 50s up to the 90s. Now she changed to video. She was first filming on the Glade, and as it shows, her life recordings from angle single aid vary up to various video formats and are forward the memory sticks. And she keeps the sticks, she's editing in the camera, and she treats the sticks like film, so she's buying a new stick when it's over, and then she files it. And so I come to an end. Maybe I just stop here and we look at another movie, and then we are finished. Yeah? Yeah. I want a 4-minute movie. The Italian one. Of course, I have a longer film now from Margaret Veit, which is documenting the Austrian airport. She did like journeys, everything. She filmed everything. And this film shows the Austrian airport in the 50s. So maybe you can imagine how an airport in the 50s looks like. So we could see another film, which will be the end of my lecture, and then we can go to a discussion and we could watch a film that is four minutes, and it's with audio, so most of some films are silent, and this would be the ending of my presentation. We skip the airport, we can watch it after. Yeah? Okay? And, of course, the film is in Italian. It's made, may I pass the translation to you? It's made by a colleague of mine, also a film archivist, who found an estate of amateur films and collects. I have some films with Ninex here, we can watch later, maybe, with Austrians, like performing cultural and everyday life stuff. And this is now, it's not amateur film, it's based on an amateur film, it's mainly let's watch. So it's archival art film in a kind of a way, and I hope this works now, and this will be the end. I'm not used to this computer. There must be the film somewhere, because I heard the sound.
Movie player.
Stop, don't watch, okay. So, and a bit up with the volume would be perfect for me.
Play
it,
you want to play it?
Play it, yes.
Space bar.
Grazie.
question about the movie maker.
That's an archival question. As we, as now we as archivists, we sometimes don't know by ourselves when it's an anonymous donation to our archive. We are like, we try to get the clues done. We see like cars or stuff like dating the films on, or the concept of time. The concept of time, which just brings up a big issue, like concept of time in an amateur film heritage like that of Margaret Veit. It shows a whole life. It shows a whole life from being a young mother from 25, elaborating, growing up, writing her life as an ego document, and keep the files of it. Yeah, and is it in that direction to experience Western time? It's like in the political discourse, the 50s were very, you know, very different in Austria and Europe after World War II, and so there was a Wirtschaftswunder, and even for women it was very hard because first they built the houses and the men were away, and then the economics rise, and then it was possible to do amateur films. And that's maybe one of your questions, is how does amateur film and female amateur filmmaking develop? Of course, amateur film just started in the 20s, and it was like brand new in the 20s, and then there was time and modernity, and that's how the people adopted film cameras. There was electrification of the city, there was speed, there were motorcycles, there were cars, and so modernity began to break in Europe. And out of that, it developed from a high bourgeois practice to a leisure practice in Austria. In the 50s, it was quite examples in the 60s and 70s. And in the 70s, it was a mass phenomenon. Is that so in that way? So it's kind of leisure culture now. And if you think it forward, you know, we're doing like the films on our phones, and it was like all analog stuff. Yeah, you had to process, you had to film it, you had to process it. It's early amateur films are very interesting because there's no zoom in it. It's very stable, and you see like car races. Even there's one project the Film Museum has done with the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, and it's part of everyday life, and we can even go back to films from 1938, where Austria was in Anschluss to Germany, like Hitler was uprising. And we have footage of this, of everyday life of on the street. So it's actually is contemporary history. You see, as contemporary history. I now focus on like this family film and home movies, but actually as research tool, you can use it for history of the city, Wirtschaftswunder, and stuff like that.
For having me. I'm Corinna and I am speaking as an artist today here. I will speak not about all feminist collectives in Austria, I will mainly speak about my own work, my own artistic practice, how I work, how we work. Of course, I mainly work in collectives. And I'm a media artist, and what we mainly, like when I say we, I usually refer to three colleagues of mine who are Carla, Julia and Anna. We also share our studio and we work together in different constellations. And we mainly make something like, we are coming from media art, but we usually do installations and sculpture now, and we use hacking of existing product as a main design strategy. It's very important for us to do most of the steps of the development of a piece by ourselves, so we usually don't outsource. I don't know about Indonesia, in Austria, especially in India.
F5. Wait, it's still loading. Yeah, okay, F5 now.
I brought tons of pictures, but I was told I have 20 minutes, so I will not go in depth. That was us, like two of us renovating our studio. It's the first one. And to come back to what I just tried to say, we are usually doing everything by ourselves, so that's why DIYing, hacking, and also like doing it together with others is a very important point for us. Why do we like to do everything by ourselves? Because we consider like from the code to the way an object would be able to move a very big or very important part of the artistic practice, and that's why we like it. And we also like it because we think this playful way of working is something which gives us a lot of joy, and that's maybe something I also want to stress. We really like to enjoy what we do, and that's why playfulness is something very relevant for our work. So again, my name is Corina, and I think because I want to focus on my practice, I also wanted to show you the spaces I am working in. It's actually three pics are coming. It's maybe to open up to Austria also a little bit. This is the view from our studio. It's in a social housing building in Austria, and yeah, we share it. This is the view from an old salt fabric in Salzburg. I'm born in Salzburg, and in my professional practice, I work a lot in this county of Austria. We do a big festival. We call it Festival for Producers or Playground of Ideas, and it's. In the basic, it's a 10-day festival where approximately 100 to 200 people share 10,000 square meters to produce together. And I think in the non-hierarchical way and in the very honest and very sharing way, this festival happened, and it's also like goes on as a network over the year, and people are coming from I think 50 different countries. I think the only one in this size in Austria. And I'm part of the Tinker Lab, so from the electronic lab there, so that's why this is also a very important view from my work. And then, last but not least, I'm also a social scientist from profession. I work in social science, like it's a half, like 20 hours a week, so to say. We do really social science work, like statistics, and that's the view from the rooftop. Like actually my office would be under this floor, but that's the place where I usually smoke. So. And it's the first district of Vienna. So this is the first district of the Austrian capital. And of course, I will just lead you to some of our projects to give you an idea how we are working, what we are doing. This is quite an old project, and actually it never happened and for real, but because I traveled 16 hours to come here, I thought I'd start with a project which is dealing about the distance between places, and we made a construction to do a 6 millimeter line of paint on the street. It was intended to mark the way from Vienna to Istanbul, but it never really worked for more than 500 meters. You could see that because there is dirt on the streets, and that's what our construction did not like care for. It was perfectly working on so clean ground, but streets are not clean. I mean, that was really a mistake in the concept, of course. Anyway, then we tried to alter the project and refer to a district in Vienna,
We did there an installation and a living book installation. It was about how the traffic for sex workers was regulated in this district. And I placed it here because that's what was coming out of our original machine, like much more we really tried to focus on a concrete space than there. Anyway, then I come to a piece which shows me, just let's watch the video. It's porcelain. Okay, so what you can see, like, we are very obsessed with materials. This was porcelain, and like they are made more or less like all from the same kind of hemispheres, but touched before porcelain was burned, so they have different shapes in their surface. And this shape, together with the all similar inner mechanism to make it run, makes in a way individual patterns for the objects. Yeah, I try to bring also always some pictures of how we produce. And movement is something we really like to shape, and if you want to shape movement, especially, like, we are not doing interactive art at all. Like, we are not so much into interaction, giving more an object, maybe something like its own way to behave. I mean, I think to shape interaction is a so complex thing. To shape interaction between an art piece and an audience is often to break down to a very basic interaction methods. And that's something like we are just not so interested into, maybe. So what's often a big challenge for us is to choreograph coincidence, because if you want to have something like, for example, these spheres, or as we see later, an object, you cannot like foresee what it will do. You have to use coincidence, and if you wanna you want to shape this great incident, you need to choreograph it in a way. So that is actually the code for a piece which is called Feather Fee. And here I tried to repair it because one of the sensors broke in a 2-month exhibition. We were very proud. It was a very hot summer. It was standing there in a glass box in a very old, it's in a 30-year-old anarchic labor in Vienna, book, so to say. It's an old artist collective that has space for a lot of different groups also. And I was standing there for 2 months, and after 2 months the sensor broke. I mean, that's good, at least for me. So there should be a video. But we are not seeing it. I can hear it.
Maybe it's in another software.
Ah, yeah, here it goes. I'm sorry for my videos, I really sampled them down to include them in the presentation. We need all the feathers ourselves. And it was good, like one of my colleagues, she's a hat maker from her original profession. And that was really gold because she knew how to produce texture in a way. Yeah. Then, as I said, DIY and hacking are like design strategies for us. That's a project we exhibited, or we made this last year. And like, it was a big net of wooden sticks, more or less, and it went into a gallery space. And we 3D printed and laser cut it all our shapes and our, how you call this,
the joints,
yeah. We used a lot of open source examples to print the joints.
Yes.
And I have a video, this is in a fab lab in the Netherlands where we did the first prototypes. And that was actually like the first idea to try to work with this, the way flowers would open up, and try to use this to get a maximum movement from small circles. Here we work then, that's a very recent project. It's about, maybe I skip it because I want to come to something more experimental, which would also lead the track to the another collective, to this festival collective I referred first to. We love to experiment, and here we see Michi Hackel invited in our studio. He is part of a collective we call the Club of Tille Fantasi. It's just between fantastic and dilettantismus. No, I mix up the words.
Huh?
Amateurs. It's more about amateurs in different things. Yeah. So here we try to make these sparkling sticks we would like for Christmas. We tried to do it to make a paint, to paint walls, and then so that you could light the paint and it would give a sparkly picture. We failed until now, but we are still trying. Like here you can see our perfect laboratory. Yeah, that was our first success. Unfortunately, it was not working on wall. Because the problem with walls is that they are usually very cold. So what you usually use for sparkling sticks is either metal or wood or something like this. And these are materials who, as the carrying materials, heat up themselves. So if you have a wall, then you need a much more burning process, fastening, glue or substances, and until now we haven't found out which one could work. So another project we did, and it's not because it's so super serious, and it's of course not super serious, we tried to do, like, you know, small molecular kitchen, we tried to do vodka orange, but vodka orange in eggs, having the consistency where you would open the egg and it actually looks like an egg, but it's orange juice in vodka. A very, yeah. So we tried this, and this idea was first tried at Schmiede, and Schmiede is the festival I told you about first, where people are coming together to produce more or less sensible ideas, so to say. And I think it's really a place for creators or for people who also like to see what others are doing or for collaboration. And it's situated in Salzburg. Maybe I just told you. Yeah. I'm one of the three people who is in charge for Tinker Lab. Like in the last years, we built up a structure with little labs, but I don't think that the labs are the places where actually the experiments or something like this are happening. It's more like a base for people who are interested in to find a place to exchange. So, we do little workshops. Like this was a keyboard hack workshop from a guy called Captain Klaus. He is the captain of a nomadic artist collective. Like I think it's mainly artists from Europe. They are meeting up once a year, and they, like, what they share is that they love to produce on the road. Like, it's always really cool when you visit there. They get them together because they all have mobile homes and they have their ways to create and so on. And here he showed us how he is hacking keyboards to design his synthesizers. This was a DIY Lens Baby workshop. And last year we also had a talk from, there are also talks, maybe this is the message. And then, which is maybe interesting for you also, Tinker Lab and Schmiede are collaborating with Subnet. Subnet is a media art institution in Salzburg, and there is a residency program, and the residents are usually invited for Schmiede as well. So here we see Hanna Piana Wilson, maybe you know her. She, I think she's quite famous for what she does in with electronic fabrics. And she also came back this last year to Schmiede because she really liked it and did her own e-textile lab. Yeah, so this is the kitchen of Schmiede. There is a guy who does Ayurveda kitchen for 200 people. I think vegan and vegetarian. I think it's quite amazing. And maybe for the end, I show you, like, there are so many projects coming out of Schmiede. I brought some videos from collectives I have nothing to do with, but I mean, maybe just to give you an impression of this festival. And I chose the Shadow Monsters because it also is an introduction to Schmiede. 2030.
what you see is one of the processing rooms for salt. Like, I think the electric towers.
Do you have questions to Corina about the hacker practices of these families? How did you do it? Why?
So could you just talk a little bit more about the collaboration and how you work together and how the organization works?
Yes, like about my artist collective. We are four, and it developed in a very organic way. Like with most of them, I had contact when we studied together, and like with two of them, I've worked now for almost 10 years, and the other, Carla, she's also from Salzburg, and when we finished art school, then there is the problem, like the thing is that you in Austria you can apply for funding where you are born. And for example, for me it's like this, I was born in Salzburg, I grew up in Upper Austria, that's two different countries, and now I live in Vienna, and actually like in Salzburg I can ask for money for projects. So we started to work together, and then we started to apply there together, and like we started to get involved in this scene in the one hand, and for our artistic practice, I mean, there are some, for me it's sharing a space is something which has a lot to do with trust, and like also working together in environments. We all have other jobs, we all earn our money. We earn money with our art, but we earn our, like, the places we live in, we don't earn with our art. So, you have to trust somebody, and you have to, I also like it to know what they are good in, and to, so, yeah, that's maybe a thing, right? And now we come together for a project and work on them. That's maybe the thing. And like, we never said about ourselves that we are actually a feminist collective, but we work together because we, and what I think is very important that in this group, we all have the time to develop our solutions, and nobody too much interferes into the development of of maybe an answer to a problem by one person. And I, for example, when we go to Fab Labs and to make stuff, then we usually choose not the most hacky space lab in Vienna, because there usually people tell us what to do, and so we usually go to the more institutionalized places because there nobody interferes, and we are all like, we don't like interfering so much actually. But I mean, that's how we like it, so to say. Kind of about our space, like we have in a way a strange studio, because this is our third studio together, and what we found out in the first two is that we don't need our own working places, like our fixed working places. That's a big difference. For example, now we also were looking for a person to share, and that's a thing like we usually ask for it. Where is my desk? We don't have something like my desk, because we found out that if you just need a place to place your computer, then that's not a big thing, yeah? So we have like personal shelves, but we have not personal desks, which means you have to clean up after you do normal stuff. And if you need more space for some time, you have to tell the others, like write an email. It's not a problem, but it's unusual.
I guess on that kind of conversation, is there ever tensions around authorship or people getting ideas and the collaboration being unbalanced?
I didn't get the question.
I guess, does it always feel like equal collaboration, or because you work together so much, one person might have an idea and that's supported by someone else and so on?
We group around project differently, and we usually develop together. But that's just for my studio. And I do stuff, for example, just with Carla, and also I said just with Julia, so to say. It's not like you have to do this, but it's really flexible, and it's also a grown thing in a way. But and we of course have our like things we are better in than others. For example, Julia is just great with pictures. Like, I would never give a picture out of a hand before she has seen it, because she's just great. You know, her opinion is always of big value for me. But sometimes, of course, it does, because she always takes a lot of time. And if there is a deadline, then maybe my decision is the better, because it's faster, so to say. But, you know, it's more like this.
Thank you so much, Corinna.
Yes, thank you again for the invitation. I Stephanie approached me with this with her grandmother's project, and I was thinking a lot since I turned 38 if I'm already a grandmother or not. And I was thinking a lot of what intergenerational knowledge transfer can do, because it's very difficult from the artistic practice. I also work as Corinna in many different collectives, and it seems to me that it's a very female practice to work in collective, also to a lot of knowledge exchange without knowing. And and now with our collective of experimental radio, we really try to pass on knowledge, or try to find an approach how to do it actually. And this is why I'm here. So I'm not fully, I cannot show you what we've done. I can show you what we try to do, or what I'm trying to do, and not what we successfully did. But this is actually one of the first approaches. It's Kasper, he's the son of Maria, who is also on this picture. He's part of the Radio Collective family. I'm also showing you a couple of pictures from the space I'm sharing with Stephanie, because we're in the same space and also have a collective together, which is inspired as a laboratory, which I joined only 2.5 years ago. And we finally managed to have a very nice space in Vienna. And I'm trying to show you a couple of things on by what means I tried to create some kind of a knowledge transfer as a grandmother in experimental radio in Austria in the community radio. Community radio was only established 16 years ago in Austria. It's a very young thing. And it's due to the fact that we had a monopoly on radio as well as on TV for many years, and it was only broken 16 years ago. So to give you an example, the oldest community radio station in Europe is Radio Student from Slovenia, and they are now 41 years old, so it's quite a difference. And the same problem we have in Germany, whereas in other countries there have been a lot of free or community radio. Our group is Radio FM, and we established it 2006 by the means of getting money from the European Commission, and it was written by Fiona Steinert and Clement. I forgot his second name, which is quite embarrassing. And the thing was that I never managed to get a grant by the European Commission. But we managed to establish a network, starting with 6 radio stations through the whole of Europe. And now we've got approximately 26 radio stations exchanging experimental radio all through Europe, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, and the United States. So we are very Eurocentristic or Western-centristic, which I try to change. Guys, join us. And this is also one of the important things in it. So with the question of transferring knowledge, we have to ask ourselves, especially since I work in many collectives which don't exist, only virtually exist, or exist on a virtual basis. Is there a difference between digital analog exchange or knowledge transfer, and how can you actually transfer the knowledge between analog, digital, and post-digital? A very important thing is how to deal with censorship. The Austrians always think it's not so important, but it is quite, because we have a lot of censorship even in Austria. It's not so obvious as in other countries. How to include different positions, so it's the normal things, and how to actually decentralize the knowledge transfer and put it on a wide base. So that's the questions, and also the main question for me is really, what is a generation? Because when it comes to experimental radio in the community stations within Austria, I'm really a grandmother, but when it comes to experimental radio itself, I'm not a grandmother at all. It started actually in the early 20s with noise artists in Russia, and also a big movement in Austria and Germany, mainly coming from artists and musicians a lot. So there was a lot of noise music actually in the 1920s in Russia and Austria. And then it was more or less passed on to the more theater-oriented radio drama section. So the experimental radio, the artist radio, had this slight movement, and in Austria it never really happened, this movement. So there's quite a continuation of experimental radio. So I did a speech 2 years ago, and we were talking about how to create belonging and inclusion. If you want to create some kind of knowledge transfer, you have to create inclusion, belonging, and availability. So that's what I think. So availability of people that actually are willing to transfer knowledge. And I'm really talking not about an online archive or a video archive, but like here you need this common space where you all meet, and you even have it like an arena, so it's really a common meeting ground, and there have to be people that are willing to transfer this knowledge that we are doing and why we are doing this, and how to use the maybe analog or digital reachable information and knowledge. So I thought of this very important inclusion process that people have to have some kind of belonging to workspace, otherwise they won't want to transfer anything. And it also works as Corina mentioned, the trust section, and it has a lot to do with the question of failing, because in most you really have to have some kind of ground where you're able to fail and you're able to pass on the failings. And I show a few pictures. So, and I also play you something quick.
We're a group of stations bringing new and forgotten ways of making radio to our listeners. Each week we give artists the challenge to make radio that works across the whole of Europe and beyond. Are you up for it?
Yet another annoying piece of radio art. This is this tradition. In the beginning, there was a paraphrase. Starting from the search for radio arguments to be reproduced, we ended up looking into landmarks of radio history in connection with art, hopping from its beginnings to a digital turn. Listen to a simulation of history and how it digged out of its holes. We paraphrased the first transmissions, terrestrial and via telephone line, transmitting saloon music from the Hotel Intercontinental into a dining room in a private apartment, and sang the Syrian hymn through a pirate radio transmitter. In search of elements of radio history, we are reusing the key idea of a performance by GX Jupiter Larsen. The paraphrase alters the original by tuning the varied radios into the transmission of the simulated historical radio events. A mini private transmitter is used to transfer the signal from a nearby computer to the radio stations in a beam filled with story. A radio show by Christina Fromm, Lado und Gertja Dahler, Fiona Steiner, supported by Barbara Kaiser, Karl Schönsrecker, Sarah Morris, Christine Schöpfiger, and Judith Burkert-Hofer.
Performed by digging a hole in a garbage bin full of dirt and small radios. All of the radios were turned to static. So as the hole got larger, the radio static got louder. Entitled Building Empty Holes, this solo performance lasted 15 minutes. This performance took place in Vienna, 1991, at the Museum Moderner Kunst.
On a very playful and joyful way, so we really digged radius into the soil, and I put piezos on the shovel, so we shoveled the mounds, and we made a radio transmission with a microFM transmitter. We built we transmitted from the Hotel Intercontinental, where there is actually still salon music, because one of the first radios was actually the production of salon music, where they had music in hotels and in places, you know, like all places. And they were trying to transfer, like have only one orchestra that plays for several ball houses. So that was the first more or less transmission of art with the means of broadcasting. And this one was actually a telephone line, one of the first telephone lines. So we reenacted this, they had dinner at home, and I was at the Hotel Intercontinental transferring with a mobile phone the sound of the band there. So now the question is, what does this have to do with knowledge transfer in experimental art? The thing is that it was very difficult actually to get any information on artistic practice itself that can be transferred. I found it very difficult in exchange with a very young, one of our granddaughters, Christina Fromm. She was joining our group that had already been there for quite a while. It was very difficult to actually get the information on how experimental radio was done. Like, you had recordings, but you hardly have any documentation on it. It's a problem. And then there's also the problem that this reenactment, what does it do to you in the artistic practice? It's a very funny thing. It happened like in the last couple of years. It's happening. Reenactments are happening all through artistic practices. A lot of reenactments. The last 5 or 7 years, you find it very often, especially in the there are a lot of dancing performances with reenactments in the last couple of years. So I wonder why they do this. It's really to get back the practice and to transfer some kind of knowledge by the practice. This is a question I want to ask you, how you do it. Because when we talk about this, then we have to talk about so-called tacit forms of knowledge, which is knowledge that is, we are not knowing that we pass it on. So if I have a group of people and we do certain things in a certain way, especially in intergenerational knowledge transfer, then we don't know how we actually do it, we just do it. We haven't found a code for it, we haven't found a notation for it, we just do it, and in most cases we don't even know that we are actually transferring something to people. So therefore I have a game for you to try to make some kind of knowledge transfer here.
I'm the interactive person. We have cards here, and who knows how to shovel? I don't know. Yeah? And it's very interesting because it's a practice everybody does quite differently. Who wants to learn that? Do you want to learn it? Because it's really difficult. I've been doing this with my nephew since he's 10 and now he's 23. And
to shuffle the card?
Yes. And to transfer how to shuffle cards. How do you do it? So can you try to teach it to somebody who cannot do it?
And then I play.
Has everybody managed
to teach. So frustration is one of the first things doing, learning frustration, overcoming frustration. I'm a really bad frustrated person. But what is interesting about this example is especially that only you chose to juggle them differently.
So once somebody starts with one system, then you continue this system in the whole community. So if we start to juggle them like this, everybody
will follow the same pattern
of doing it like this. So it's a very nice example for the mimetic behavior we have as human beings. We
do what we see. I'm a really bad mimetic behavior. So did you actually manage to teach it?
Yes, he managed to teach it actually.
Yeah. I mean, how did you say it? Did you show it or did you explain what to do or?
Both.
Nobody showed me.
Now the nice thing about exactly. Thank you. This is how I did it for many years. And then
that's what I
did. So you have you have one system shuffling cards. It's totally plural. All shuffling card systems are quite equal, although one is quicker than the other.
So all shuffling card things are quite equal. One is quicker than the other. I like that best, because you get to know the cards. Because the nice thing about, if you shuffle the cards like you did it, they get destroyed easily. So if you're thinking of long-term using cards, you wouldn't shuffle them like that. You'd probably use a different system. And this is what so this is now the question, how can you bring on, pass on this on an equal base in communities? Different systems, same solution, same effect, different solutions. Some destroy the systems, some don't. If you shuffle them like that, all the cards get lost. So that's also a bad thing. So I find it very difficult in this intergenerational knowledge transfer, what system you use and how can these systems be equal and how can they be equally used. Now you wonder, what does this have to do with radio? Because nobody really tried to shuffle them on a sonic base. So how can you shuffle cards that they make a lot of noise? It's not so easy. So if the transfer system is not a visual one, looking and doing a mimetic transfer, how can you do it on a listening base, for example? Can you teach shuffling cards just by using words or sounds? Yeah, just an example. So this is opening up the problem of knowledge transfer itself in these tested forms of knowledge. Because in most cases we basically don't know why we're doing things. And the question now is, why do you shuffle the cards like you do? Did you learn it from your mother, your father, your grandparents? Who showed you? People at school? Who is there? Who actually teaches you these kind of things? And we from the free radio, the community radio, really tried to make radio, or try to teach making radio also, or bring from the artistic practice radio closer to people from that kind of things. When was the first time you made a radio show? Make it more from the base. Don't be so afraid of the tools, and try more to get a democratic way of using tools. Okay, but how to do it actually? So I put this rather interesting quotations out. It's Wendy Gardner. She wrote a lot on the constructing of
belonging and memory. And so what I try to use as an artist is try to use theories of other people and maybe they fit. And with her it really fits, I think she's a very good social scientist. And then we come to the most problematic thing, especially in the transfer of knowledge, is that you have to have a continuation of a group. Like if I say, Corinna, I want to join your artist collective with Carla, then I don't know what will happen because you're a fixed group. So the question of transparency within a group is very important. We really try to ask new people to join our group in order to be able, and other people leave the group actually, in order to be able to have some kind of transfer process. Yeah, and then that's the last thing. Availability is the most important thing, actually, if you want to have an intergenerational knowledge transfer. And I mean not only physical availability, but also virtual availability. It doesn't really matter. It really brings a point to a lot of artist groups who produce more or less representative art. I mean, they are not as people. They are usually not available. How can you transfer if you're not available? In Austria, we have, I mentioned it today, we have quite a traditional handcraft. We have a big traditional handcraft, a handcraft tradition. And this knowledge transfer that's happening there is it's very intensive. They have a problem in the last couple of years, but it's very intensive. We have it in Germany. It's a dual system of education. You're in school and you are also in some kind of handcraft. Wrong pictures, yeah. So you are in the school, and on the other hand, you are in this case, they are in hotels, working there. And 8 hours a week they have to go to school, so this is a dual system. And there is quite a big, very traditional knowledge transfer happening within these dual systems that makes up a very successful companies in Germany and Austria. But the interesting thing about it, it's very conservative, this knowledge transfer, it's held by Inumen, they're very male-orientated, it's very traditional, and it's very exclusive in terms of they have a lot of exclusion. If you don't behave, the group wants you to behave, you're out at a very young age, basically, if you do an apprenticeship. So you really have to behave in the company, and then you have to behave in the school, and that's not really an environment for, I think, nowadays, society. And there's the last thing I show, it's a workshop I do on a regular basis at the community radio where we build a radio FM transmitter and teach it to people who had never soldered their whole life. And it was really fantastic. The last time we had two persons that really, like, they never soldered, and it's a wonderful work. And I only worked with them for a day. Yes, so I was very proud. Okay, I want to finish here. I know I haven't answered many questions, but probably you can ask questions and I can try to answer what is happening.
questions to Lade, the radio pilot.
I wish to see more of the practical example of your work, like
yes,
how is this,
yeah. How does it look, or
yeah, how does it look, you know, how does it sound?
So I only prepared, you know, I only had one radio show which we did that was, you heard, that was one of the works in the collective, the radio collective.
The radio show you heard, that was one of the works in the radio collective. I have many examples of collectives, but I did not prepare them. Since I'm more or less a sound artist, I also made a lot of installations. My website is horrible. It's been redone, and it will be finally really, really good, hopefully at the end of April. But I can.
Do you plan to do it here? Like,
I can show you a few things. So this is from the audio work. I also teach sound in public space. I did it last year at the same institute where Stephanie was teaching, and I'm trying to continue this teaching 2016, so it would be cool. Here is some really traditional radio drama. Do you want to listen? So the text is from a very young author from the Ukraine, Katya Buchniak. She was very young then, now she's quite a grown up woman. It's from 2007. And I made the direction of the music and production.
Der Schnee grünte direkt in meine Augen. Frech schmilzte in meinen Ohren. Vielleicht entschuldigt er sich so für seine Existenz und für die Offenheit des Winters, der es nicht schafft, die Fußgänger zu küssen. Und die Koketterie berührt der sanften frierenden Seelen, um darauf eine Antwort zu bekommen. Doch meine Eigenart spielt so, als würden wir uns gar nicht kennen. Zwar haben wir uns fast getroffen, dann doch aber verpasst. Wie alte Liebhaber, die alles hatten und nichts daraus geschnitzt haben. Und was sie geschnitzt haben, ist besser zu vergessen.
This was installed in a public space in a tram in Görlitz. It's a split city. And one half of the city belongs to Germany and the other half belongs to Poland. Yes.
And the story is about?
The story is about a couple a sister and a couple and a sister of this couple. And she talks to strange people on her balcony in Janowitz, in the Ukraine. It's a very interesting, and she interferes with this relationship between the two of them. It was translated by Irina Ivanina from Ukrainian. And there is also there's more, now I only play basically, there's a more noise-oriented thing with literature that I do a lot.
from the Tea Time Collective. I founded a collective of electronic tea time. We make music with any means. A few pictures of something. That's the one you heard with the installation in the drama, Drama in a Drum. The youngest listener. It's always good to have children in the picture. Yeah, live broadcasting from an exhibition of Gang Machine. That's a project I do with Octagon de Lena. It's a series from 2008. Yeah, installation that took place in the Volksbühne in Germany. Yeah, next time probably more.
Thank you so much to all the speakers and the great audience. And now I hand over to Pita and Eva.
Cheers. Thank you so much. I'd like to thank you, Lalo, Tatao, Tito, and also Stephanie, for sharing so many